You're listening to the Disc Golf Show.
Hey, everybody, and welcome to the Disc Golf Show, episode number 7. That's right. You can't see my next camera, but I pointed to it anyways. This show, and probably all the rest of them, are going to be brought to you by Final Nine Sports with two locations, and that's in California, Nick, before you correct me.
Yes.
Or add to it. In California, Orangeville and Rockland. Two of them. Stop in, support local, support your local.
Yes.
Pro shop, because you should. I know it's easy to buy stuff online. Nick knows it's easy. He doesn't care. He still does it. But don't be like Nick. Support local. Okay. Support. I just made that up. It's Rob Meyer. He supports probably locally more than I do, but support local. That's the thing. Final Nine Sports, if you're here in California, Orangeville, Rockland, check them out. My name is Justin, and don't you forget it. I don't know why I'm angry about it. And this guy.
I'm Nick. How's it going?
He's here too.
Yeah. Unfortunately
can't
for you.
Can't get rid of him.
All right. If we're going to jump right in to this.
We're going to get sued.
He does not have that copywritten or registered or whatever you want to call it. I don't think.
I don't know. Don't you just have to say something and you're like.
He doesn't watch
copyright.
Us.
Restricted. Yeah. And that's how it works,
I
right?
copyright the word the.
Right.
You can't use it unless you pay me 5 cents.
True. Okay.
Every time.
So maybe just more hate mail would
Nick
be more like what's
at discgolfshow.com.
Nick at discgolfshow.com. When I start that, there's going to be a flood.
So from our last show.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know about you,
that's
but
right, you don't.
I am a huge let's not overdo it.
Oh, there's a lot of things I could use to follow that statement.
Yeah, let's not overdo it.
You are
let's
a huge insert blank here.
A lot of people could probably fill it up. I do have to say, I am more of a fan of okay. Luke Humphries mm-hmm. than prior.
Okay, why?
Due to
why?
If you haven't watched it, watch his interview on Tour Life with Brody and Yuli. You should know why. If you don't, you're a liar. So let's move on. It's a really good interview. His attitude, his personality.
Oh,
if
you don't like him after watching the show,
you're a liar.
Oh, okay, yeah. Okay. That makes sense.
Or a horrible person. I mean.
Really?
You're a horrible person.
Is he like saving small children and kittens? And
no, he's just a nice guy. Just watch it. What? I do want to do a quick shout out to this last weekend. Mm-hmm. I volunteered at the local.
Look at you getting out in the community.
Used to be uh-huh. a main stop for the pros back in the day. The St. Patrick's Classic, which they have an AM weekend and a pro weekend.
Tell me you're an old disc golfer.
Last weekend.
Without
not
telling me.
Yeah, not this last weekend. Mm-hmm. Technically 2 weekends ago.
Okay.
Was the pro weekend. And I was fortunate enough to be asked to do the cards at the beginning of the rounds. So I would gather them over and mm-hmm. send them on their way, right? And
gotcha.
Wish them the best. I was extremely surprised because though there were no junior divisions,
mm-hmm.
there was a kid there that was playing in pro and he's 16 years old and he dominated
wow.
this event, which is an A tier. It's always been an A tier, but like I said, in the past, it used to be a major stop. It was
wow.
a stop for all the pros, but
16?
Yeah. And it's basically like a stepping stone
yeah.
for the area now, moving up.
Do they do the whole 27 still?
No. So what was okay. cool about this year was completely changed.
Okay.
Big shout out to Final Nine and all the volunteers there, Casey, Bruce, Jen. They were the TDs and all
yep.
that. But everybody else who helped out there, the spotters and the vendors and everybody. This year, so in past years, it's been a Friday, Saturday, Sunday event. Friday and Saturday, they had 10 temp holes in this area that they called the Poison Oaks because this is Shady Oaks
right.
in Orangeville. And they would take one of the holes out, the normal holes out, and then they had 10 temps. So that would make the 27, right? This time, they did 3 rounds of 22. What they did, and it was the same
okay.
layout for AM weekend
mm-hmm.
and pro weekend. So if you played both weekends, which I think there was a few people that actually did, mm-hmm. you got a preview, But what was cool, and I think this is probably what they're going to be doing moving forward, is the three rounds of 22. And what they did is they had the full 18. No, they had 17 because they combined holes 9 and 10 into a par 4.
Okay.
And then they had 5 holes out in the back by the horse arena and back where some of the temps used to be only on pro weekend.
Okay.
So if you want to check this event out, I highly suggest, one, you'll get to see Aviel Gomez, 16-year-old, up-and-coming phenom. Pay attention. He's probably going to be moving up the ranks. Play this whole round. Now, we do want to give a shout-out to Premium Disc Golf. If you don't know who they are, they do some local coverage. They're out of Tahoe, Lake Tahoe, but they come down and they ended up filming the final round lead card.
Right.
So go check that out. You'll see this young kid just no fear putting. He was committed. When I saw him prior to the rounds, he was putting to his dad. Like, he would putt, and then he'd step back a few, and then he'd putt, and he'd step back a few, and he'd putt. So, like, he has
interesting. Okay.
Yeah, he has this routine.
All right.
And he, dude, if you watch the coverage, it's encouraging to see because he's so young, and he beat out all these people that have played this event.
Yeah.
Like, you know?
And Shady Oaks, that course is not easy, especially when they put in all the temples.
Yeah, well, those back, so the Poison Oak area, the quote-unquote Poison Oak holes, those weren't even a part of it this year. So the ones that were a part of it were the ones that were, like I said, more out in the open, so you're not as stuck and so tight back there.
It doesn't matter. That course is hard enough.
Yeah, it is a more technical course than anywhere else. But anyways, I just want to give shout-out to Aviel for doing a fantastic job out there.
It's awesome.
Playing smart as well. When he was coming up to the final holes, he actually knew that he didn't have to run it. So he laid it. He only went one by one, which is probably why he laid it up. But just wanted a big shout out to that young man that is, like I said, you'll be hearing more from him. Because he's been playing apparently for 8 years. But he's only been I think PDGA for... five, four, something like that. But anyways.
Well, that's awesome. I hope to see you.
Great win.
And your name at the top more often.
Yes, Aviel Gomez. Remember that.
Aviel Gomez.
Moving forward here, if you haven't, I would highly suggest going and checking out on all the socials, Levi's Lapidary.
I had no idea what a lapidary was until I saw it.
You're welcome.
You're expanding my vocabulary.
I learned you something, didn't
you,
I?
You did.
Okay, so...
You learned me good.
So what's cool about this is, like, you've heard of Treasures of the Forest, right?
Yep.
The guy who does the wood minis and the acrylic and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Amazing awesome work. Stuff. Super awesome. Go check him out as well. Mm-hmm. So Levi's Lapidary, a lapidary is somewhere where you go for gems, stones, rock, all that stuff.
Right.
So guess what he does? He makes minis. Not just that, though. Okay. He recently... started, because I think it was a buddy of his said, hey, you should try doing this. Mm-hmm. He started making, very recently, started making rock stone minis. And they are beautiful.
And it says they're priced around $35, $50, and $65, depending on the value of the stone and the quality and the pattern and the colors.
Yeah.
With most like gems, you know, or different stones, there's different kinds and qualities. And I mean, if you ever get into like looking at diamonds, you know,
geez, that would be an expensive mini.
Oh my gosh. But it's kind of the same, right? Like rocks and gems, and there's different qualities and cuts and patterns.
Exactly.
So depending on what those are, varies the price of the mini. But
so these
I
prices,
get my hands on some of these. Yeah, they sound cool.
These prices are, this is recent that, like I said, that he started this. So I've been talking to him here and there, and it may not be set in stone.
Oh, see what you did there.
But that's kind of what he initially stated. They might be around those
in that
prices.
Range.
Yeah.
I mean, you think about it though, just for the ability to have one of these as a conversation starter on the course.
Yeah.
You know, you're pulling out your mini, it's this big stone thing, and somebody's like, whoa, What is that? That's cool.
Go, yeah, right? Go.
I like things like that, you know, yeah. Like on people's bags and stuff. And
same.
Like, what's that? And there's usually a story to it.
Exactly.
Or,
exactly.
You know, or at least you're like, oh, dude, these are stone minis. You got to go to this guy. Dude, look them up. They're cool. You know, like.
Yeah. And it could remind you of, it can be anything. It can be sentimental related, yeah. Anything
maybe
like that.
Your birthstone, yeah. Or, you know, something like that.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. So again, Levi's Lapidary. Go check it out. Mm-hmm. My Instagram, Facebook. I don't know if he has a Twitter, but I know he has Instagram and Facebook. Okay. But I would check him out everywhere. I think he does.
Levi's Lapidary. Sounds like an ice cream place.
Levi's,
you know, oh, lapping it up. Lapidary.
Okay. It's not. Anyway, though.
I know.
It's
I know.
Not. The next thing is that, and I saw somebody comment on this as well. Wysocki, because he's going out on his season tour now.
Mm-hmm.
He has his house. As an Airbnb. So if you are a Sake fan, a Sake Bomb fan,
I'm a Sake
or
fan,
Richard Wysocki, as they say now, because that's how it's on the paperwork.
Ricky, raptor legs.
He is Airbnb-ing his home.
Mm-hmm.
It is in Scottsdale, Arizona.
Mm-hmm.
It fits up to about 14 guests.
Wow.
It's a 5-bedroom, 3-bathroom.
It has
8 beds. It's $950 a night.
Whoa, okay. I mean, it's a pretty big place, right?
Granted, if you go and look at his feed, he's recently mm-hmm. posted it. So check that out.
I mean, that's for multiple people though.
If you look at the layout, yeah. It's a nice house. Like he's got a whole almost like a putting green for golf.
Uh-huh,
but he has like 2 or 3 baskets back there. He has a pool.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So it's a good sized house. Decent I think house. He's got a ping pong table in the garage.
Man, I don't know. It's running
expensive.
Out your house though, like think about that's real close. There's a fine line, Nick, between being a super fan and the guy that shows up that's
dude,
you smell so much different when you're awake. Like that kind of guy. Like there's a line, Nick.
That's true.
Oof,
that's true.
I don't know, dude.
That's true. But
is disc golf at the popularity level yet where you have to worry about maybe
he has it laid out to where he's not worried about the items that are in that house. Maybe he doesn't have his
security.
Trophies out and stuff like
good
that. You know
security.
What I mean?
Security, yeah.
He locks those things up when he goes on tour.
That's good security.
But yeah, go check that out. Another thing was recently, literally within the past day two. When did I send that to you?
Yeah,
Nikko
2-3 days ago.
LaCastro just made an announcement via his, or in relation to mm-hmm. his Sacred Discs manufacturer line of discs.
Yep.
And this will probably be one of the last times we talk about it, just because.
It's a little controversial, but yeah.
And like you said recently, mm-hmm. There's nothing we can do about it right now.
No, there's
actions
absolutely
nothing. Over words. Stop talking about it and actually do something, right?
Yep.
He did something.
he did.
He made his stance yeah. known in relation to women's supports and women's sports. What I mean by that is that he stated his first run prototype Lavender, mm-hmm. which is a new disc that he's releasing by Sacred Discs. Portions of the sales will go to the first female that misses cash due to playing against a transgender opponent. So he is showing his stance mm-hmm. on this issue that's been around yeah. for the past year and a half.
And as far as I know, could be wrong, correct me if I am, but I think there's only one right now.
No, there's more than one.
Is there?
I think there's
at
three.
The pro level.
I want to say it might have been age restricted pro level, possibly.
Okay.
But well, I want to say there's three competitors
at the pro level
that I think are transgender. Yeah, I believe.
Okay. Well, one of them then responded saying, oh, you know, way to make this all about me or something to that extent. Like, you know, way to make, you know, profit off of me or my name or whatever it is, or, you know,
however,
he never mentioned names.
Technically he did not.
So, I mean, we all know.
Yeah.
I mean,
because of
put
the,
it together.
Yeah.
Who is the only person in that category placing right now?
Yep.
Duh.
Yeah.
But technically, he didn't mention names. So.
Yeah.
I mean, so. That was the controversy. I'm sure you've heard it. I'm sure you're tired of hearing about it. But,
probably.
But that's the thing. That's what's there. And you know what? If you're going to put your money where your mouth is, and you're going to take action against something that, you know, you've been saying, then you know what? Good on you. All right. For whatever that cause may be. Right. Okay, good. Awesome. I'm glad you're actually doing something about it than just saying something about it.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, hey, he took the initiative to do something about it, to come up with at least probably what he considers a short-term solution to his perceived problem.
Yeah, and as we stated, as we talked about also, like, this is something that's probably going to be coming around annually. So we don't need to stretch it out across the whole season.
No.
You know?
No.
Again.
Yeah. Enough said.
Yeah.
You know?
Actions, not words. He's there doing some actions. Moving on to Cale Leiviska recently had an announcement. He did say that he's stepping away from ownership, and he sold his ownership portion of the preserve to Charlie from Gotta Go, Gotta Throw.
That's pretty cool.
He did say that he's, this is mainly due to him recently having a daughter and moving to the east side of the Twin Cities. He's saying that's obviously taking up more time, obviously, reasonably so. But he did also say that he's still going to be involved with the Preserve Championship, which is awesome.
Wait, having kids takes up time?
Something. I've heard that.
Okay. Yeah, that's weird.
I mean, they don't take up any. No, I'm just kidding. I have two, so I totally get it. Good on you. But if you don't know Cale Leiviska, he is directly connected with Prodigy. And he purchased this business, or went into partnership to purchase this business a couple years ago, two, 3 years ago. Beautiful piece of property. It is a stop on the Disc Golf Pro Tour, and you'll see it later this year.
Yeah, I'm still not really a fan of his healthy salad, but
C-A-L-E.
Got it. Okay, got confused again.
Okay, so anyways, Cale, good on you. And then we can move on to the most recent event. Well, almost the most recent event.
Almost.
Since our last show, there's been two events.
Yeah.
The first one was the Open at Austin. I did get to see some of this.
I got to see most of it.
I didn't get to see really. I saw like clips more than anything because I was unfortunately busy that weekend.
And what's kind of funny too, in a way, is I wasn't like super excited about watching it. Right. But then I remembered we have the Fantasy League. I was like, no, I'm going to watch it. It actually motivated me to like, no, I got to watch. I got to see.
What I did was I just was constantly looking at my messenger to see the trash talk that was coming out of the other four people on.
Which
my
is, that's kind of, if you think about it, it's like live updates, score updates, if you think about it.
Yeah. And if you're not watching, you could just be lied to. About
happening. which I was doing so, constantly.
That's always fun.
Like, Nick, wasn't it? Didn't you have AB? It's crazy, wasn't it?
DNF,
he broke his
man.
Leg. Yeah, that's weird. What?
But ultimately, there we had some basically big news from that. One, the MPO winner, Nicholas Antila. It was his first tour win. Elite event. And not only that, but he actually got on SportsCenter for getting an ace on one of those holes. I want to say it was hole 7, because I heard there was multiple aces on this hole that he got his ace. And there's multiple videos.
Oh man, I don't remember now, but yeah, sounds right.
And then also Owen Scoggins dominated it.
Dude,
apparently.
She is on a tear.
She won by like what? Double digits?
Dude,
or was it nine or something?
It wasn't even close.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, wow. Dude, her putting.
It's insane.
Oh my gosh, dude.
It reminds me of there's consistent putting form, a general consistent putting form, right? That brings good and victory, right? So out, and if you watch golf, there's a gentleman named Jim Furyk.
Yes.
If you know his swing, it is not normal.
Yes.
It is, but it works for him.
Hey, man. Yep.
That is how I feel about Owen, because her putting, when it comes out, it is not smooth. It's powerful. It's committed.
Yes.
It's consistent. It's repeatable for her.
Yes.
But it is wobbly as all get out. It's a duck.
Yeah.
It is a duck.
Yeah. It's the thing. So Ken and I were talking about this, and I think he's right. because he brought this up. The gentleman that's probably listening and watching right now, hi. He's in our fantasy league. And he was saying that a lot of the female pros probably put a ton of practice into drive distance. And they're concentrating on that form and getting that distance down. But like the old saying goes, drive for show, putt for dough. I think Owen Scoggins kind of took the opposite approach in that she concentrated obviously a ton on putting.
Well, if you've
and
ever seen
that's
her,
what's winning.
If you've right ever now. Heard her do interviews, mm-hmm. she'll putt like 150 putts before her round.
Right. She's putting the practice into putting and the focus yeah. on that. Because generally, you know, if you're remotely capable of driving an average distance on the field, but you can output almost everybody
if you can
there
putt from 80 feet consistently,
doesn't matter. You're going to make all of them.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. Doesn't matter where you lie. And I think it shows, especially the dude, she was crushing
yeah,
it.
Yeah.
Some well, of these it, putts she made, I'm like, oh my
it
gosh.
It shows from that score. Yeah. I saw some highlight stuff on that and that was insane. Like oh, yeah. it was, and she goes on that. That's, mm-hmm. that's the own that you got to be scared of.
I had
that's the own you got to be worried about.
I was in a couple of business meetings. Thankfully, I remembered to mute myself because it was just me going, yeah. I mean, oh, God, I'm muted. All right.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, I was totally paying attention to
that. If that's the one that shows up, you're going to be hard pressed to challenge her.
Monster.
Yeah. So big shout out to Owen. And she had a ratings record with the PDGA due to that event.
Yeah.
Because I think her average was 1,015 or 1,020 or something like that.
Oh, yeah, something like that.
So, big shout out to Owen. If you don't know, yep. you're living under a rock. Moving on to the...
That was the one to go back and watch if you missed it.
Yeah, yeah. Moving on to the USWDGC. That was mm-hmm. just this weekend. Again, so the story was... the story was...
Here we go.
The story was...
Here we go.
Basically... Can Tatar defend her mm-hmm. title? Can she? And the other story was she would be the only person, only female to win 6 majors in a row.
True.
Because she won the True. 4, right? Mm-hmm. And then I think the one previous the year before. So she's won 5, right? In a row. So
right.
She did not, if you no. don't know, she did not. Leading up to it, I did see an interview with her stating that she felt drained. She felt rushed getting into this season. Yes, I'm making excuses because she's amazing.
I was just waiting to call you out on
yeah,
it.
But I'm not making excuses. These are literally out of her mouth. She said this. She felt drained. And over the off season, if you don't follow her, it looked like she had no downtime with sponsors and events that she had to be at and in Estonia and all that stuff.
Yeah,
so
must be rough. Yeah.
Must be rough. Yeah. But however, the winner was Missy Gannon.
Absolutely. It was. And she won by a landslide.
Yeah. She came strong on the final day because I think there was one other person, right? That was challenging her near the end there. Was it Owen?
No, it was, I think it was Evelina, wasn't it?
Oh, yes. Yeah, yeah. It was Evelina, but I heard she had a couple slip-ups in the final holes.
Yep,
and
yep.
Just
yep.
Kinda
and that kind of took her out of it, sealed the deal.
Yeah, wasn't able to.
Yep.
So big shout-out to Missy. Mm-hmm. We're going to touch on the trophy gate mm-hmm. Of this event. Hi.
I love your note. I love your note in the show notes.
The final
it's the
part?
The thought that counts.
Well, here's the thing.
Trophy. It's the
if you look at it, it's pretty obvious what it is. If you don't know what it is, it's actually, there's an archway at that course.
Yeah.
That looks exactly like that.
Sure.
So it's just a miniature version of that archway.
Yeah, it has butterflies on it and they printed it up a little bit.
Here's the thing. You cannot travel with that. I mean, give them something they can travel with.
I've seen
give them
worse.
Something that isn't going to cost $200 to ship home to their
sure.
house.
Like, so what's better though, that or a chessboard?
I knew you were going to say that.
Right? Let's face it, man. The trophies in disc golf suck.
Yeah, here's the thing. Having creative liberty is a responsibility.
Right. So here's what I think would have been a little bit better. If we'd have taken that trophy and shrunk it down to a quarter of its size.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And then, like, that was, like, maybe a topper on something that was, like,
or having,
like metal or something, like a ring around it or something that, like,
yeah, like
or
having a
basket
base,
shape or
having a base, you know, that it was on with maybe a basket underneath it.
Like this. Yeah. Like this thing in the background. Like
yeah.
The,
like
the size of that basket, like, you know, maybe that big. There you go.
Yeah. That would have been better.
Yeah.
Bigger isn't always better in this case.
I'm sorry.
So you know, so,
have you been hurt?
It's every okay. day. Every day.
It's okay. This is the time, Nick. This is our show for you to come out and talk about it.
The other thing that I didn't want to touch on about Tatar, mm-hmm. after the event, actually I think it was the final round. Mm-hmm. I know after the event she touched on this, was the fact that she was under the weather.
Yeah.
And she had an ankle injury.
Yes.
And you can see pictures of it. It doesn't look great.
It looks
horrible.
Yeah.
I want mm-hmm. ideal world. I want all these top FPO players to be tip top shape going into majors.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
So
it just, you know, sometimes
it doesn't
kind of sounds like she had to like wheel herself. Well,
yeah, right. Yeah. Well, the funny thing is that in the interview leading up to it, she even said this. She goes, you know, like whatever happens, she's very, again, I've said this in the past, she's very gracious.
Oh, sure. Yeah, yeah.
In her off course manner.
Yeah.
Like she's not expecting. She doesn't expect to win.
Sure.
She plays her best and whatever happens, happens.
Let's put it this way. I like Tatar. I really do. And so far, you know, coming back into this and watching this year from the beginning, I'm waiting to see it. I'm waiting to see that top caliber dominating FPO player. I haven't seen it yet.
If you were around last year.
I know, but that was last year.
Yeah, that's true.
You know?
That's true.
And everybody has a rookie season, right? That terrific start.
Valid.
If you're a fan of the Niners, just take any quarterback you've ever had.
Hate mail can go to.
And you'll know what that rookie first year kind of phenomena is, right?
Yep.
Just saying. We'll see. Maybe, you know, just, hey, she needs a little time
to warm back up
and get back
fit,
into it. Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
Like Simon. Simon.
Hi, Simon.
That better be the case.
Listen,
okay?
Simon.
You're on my roster this year. All right. I bypassed a lot of people to pick you up, mainly to aggravate him, but you are my favorite player. You need to pick it up. Okay. Pep talk done. Just needs time to warm
you're
up.
Not,
and maybe that's all it is.
You're not on my team, Simon. But I will not be mad if you win. Okay.
That's the same thing. That's the bad thing about the fantasy league is you're like, no, but I really want that guy to win.
Yeah.
Like, I really like AB, but I also don't want him to win.
You know what's funny, though?
I
just thought about this.
Mm-hmm.
Technically, neither of us can win, so we can root for whoever we want.
It's true. Moral of the story, Ken. We might have to resort to cheating.
Yeah, all right. Yeah.
And Nick is not below that.
yes, I am.
Yes, he is.
Yes, I am.
Yes, he is.
Okay, so leading up into the next upcoming show, our episode 8, there's going to be another event before then. That event next weekend is going to be the 2024 Texas States Disc Golf Championships. That is this coming weekend, March 29th to 31st in Houston, Texas. What?
Is it actually Texas States Disc Golf Championship or Texas State
no,
Disc Golf Championship?
Texas States.
Really?
I believe that's what it listed on. That's how I typed it in. I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure that's right.
It's probably right, and I've just missed it, and I've been saying Texas State this whole time.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, going into this event, your Skip Ace team aside... Okay, Skip Ace team aside.
Uh-huh.
Like, we weren't playing that.
Okay.
The previous winners last year were Calvin Heimberg.
Right.
For MPO, and FPO was Cyananda.
Okay.
I know you don't know who Cyananda is.
I saw her play this
okay, so you tournament. You caught some. Okay. Mm-hmm. What percentage possibility is there that either of these people take the win this weekend?
I mean, I don't think Sai's game was going that well, and I don't know if that was this course in this particular tournament. It was just a little rough for her, because this is honestly the first time that I've seen her play was in this tournament. So given that one, I mean, she'll be top 10, but I don't think winning it. Calvin Heimberg, man, I know everybody talks about him and how good he was last year, but I haven't seen it yet.
He hasn't done much this
year. I haven't seen it yet. It's like the Tatar thing, right? Like the previous winners from last year. Okay, that was last year.
Yeah.
Right? Like we you know, I'm more excited to see the players like Scoggins and what's his name? Burr play, you know, like these people like I've seen kind of come up and, you know, and Nicolas and Tila and stuff like they're hot right now, right?
Oh yeah.
And maybe this is their course, right? And this is where they're going to come alive, and the rest of them, we'll see them take off.
I think that's a big
tough thing. But I think these two players, top 10 at least, because their caliber's up there. They've been playing, you know,
yeah,
but not at the lead card or the chase card caliber in some cases, right? So I don't know. We'll see. According to their performance so far, no.
Yeah.
But I'd love to be surprised.
I think I think that there's a couple things here. Leading into it, mm-hmm. the Antela and Scoggins mm-hmm. coming off their victory from 2 weekends ago.
Right.
They can't really... Obviously, the MPO isn't coming off of a win from last weekend.
Right.
Or this last weekend. But Nicholas, after his weekend at Austin and having a down weekend... Will he, instead of feeling like he's rushed into an immediate next event, having some rest in between, I'm wondering if that'll be a benefit to him, if that'll help him kind of subside his energy that he had after that big win that he's been wanting for so long and he finally got it. Maybe he'll be able to collect himself a little better and he'll have a little bit of extra time to do so.
Maybe.
And then come in strong on this and maybe get two in a row. Two in a row is tough nowadays.
It's
tough.
Because the competition is everybody's so good at the top.
Well, and defending anything now is tough because of that same thing.
Right.
So it's almost like a coin flip nowadays.
Do you think that the caliber of player, and I can't speak to this, but over the past couple of years from your point of view, has it gotten stronger than in years past? Like, is the skill level going up?
I think that the dedication is a lot stronger.
Okay.
To the craft or whatever mm-hmm. you want to call it.
And that could be too, because being a top pro now, especially if you're winning a lot, it's more of a getting closer to that livable wage.
Oh, it's right? definitely. As a pro. Definitely. Right? Yeah, definitely.
And then you add in sponsors and stuff, and it's definitely more than enough, right?
Exactly.
But the player that's not necessarily, you know, first, second all the time, but, you know, they're coming in 10th place or something, the prizes are getting up there.
I'm sure those podium bonuses aren't bad either.
Not at all. You know? So maybe that's why, you know, I don't know. I was just kind of thinking about it. Like, are we seeing the skill level kind of rise because more people can dedicate more time to it because they don't have to focus as much on the, you know, secondary thing out of their primary thing, which is disc golf?
Well, think about it. Let's say it plateaued.
Mm. Okay.
Let's say it plateaued when Paul got his 10 for 10, right?
Okay.
Let's say that was a plateau and we're still at that level, which I know we're past that, but let's mm-hmm. say that's where it's at.
Okay.
That's the top player.
Yes.
Give me half that. Give me $500,000 a year to play disc. Give me $100,000 a year to play disc golf. I would be playing disc golf right now.
Sure.
So so the livable wage thing and
that's what I'm saying.
That's definitely.
But coming down the leaderboard.
Just from winnings, you're talking about.
Though. Exactly. Because that's when you start seeing more time being able to be put into that sport, right?
It's definitely taken much more seriously now. I can say
absolutely.
That.
So if your day job can be disc golf, you're going to be better at it.
Yeah.
You should get more time to dedicate to it.
Yep, exactly. Right? Yeah.
So is the skill level rising as a result?
I think so. I think, like I said earlier, it is kind of plateauing a little bit.
Okay.
But there's always those steps that are taken as something grows like that. So there was that huge, huge rise, because of the growth over COVID and all that stuff.
Sure.
But that growth in and of itself has plateaued.
Do you think?
And there was even a little dip as well, but I still think it's on the rise, and it definitely has risen in the past 5 years.
So you think, do you think there's more room for it to rise? There's another caliber of player that is coming.
I know there is, because there's still things that we've been saying back when we did the show previously. Mm-hmm. We've been saying many things. Every little incremental thing that you can do is a benefit to your game.
Right.
Can everybody just have caddies yet?
Right.
That, I don't care if you're saying, but blah, this, and I'm used to this. Dude, listen, man. Mm-hmm. Incremental benefits is where it's at.
Sure.
If you don't have to take any of your personal energy to pick up and lift down your bag, whether it's with your dominant throwing arm or not, it's still affecting your back, your core, your shoulders, all that stuff. Yeah. Those little things are improvements.
Right.
Back when Simon and Eagle went and did that training in Switzerland, they came back and they were the first two wins in that season. So the training aspect of it still has a ton of improvement.
Okay. So
there is a lot of improvement still.
Do you think then, if the caliber of player goes up, that disc golf will change in that at the pro level, it's going to get harder?
Yes.
Like they're going to start making it, I don't know, maybe longer distances or making those baskets different. Yeah, or I know we've talked about that a little bit.
We've do you think that's coming?
And how soon do you think that is?
So if you want to move into one of these questions, I have one that's kind of related to that.
Sure. Let's go into it. Okay, but answer my question first.
Okay. So will that portion change? I don't think it will.
Okay.
There is a limit to the average pro. Mm-hmm. The average pro.
Okay.
All pros aren't AB. All pros are not throwing 700 feet on flat land.
Right.
Your pro is going to be throwing, call me wrong, I don't care, 500?
Sure.
550, where they can, at let's say 500, 550,
where they
at
get good
85,
flex.
80, 85% power.
Oh, okay, yeah, sure. Okay.
Because nobody's throwing 100.
No.
Nobody's throwing 100%.
No.
Because one, you're going to ruin your body, and two, you're not going to have any control of where it's going.
Endurance, too.
Yeah. Because, I don't think length of holes is going to be any change. I think we're pretty topped out there.
Okay.
I want to say the longest course is around 12,000 feet, I think.
Yeah, somewhere in there, yep.
You're right. A lot of them are around 10 to 11, so like for MPO again. Yeah. I don't think it's going to, I don't think the course itself and that is going to change. What I do think needs to change is consistency in the tools that are used by, and I'm not talking about discs. Mm. I'm talking about tee pads and baskets. And I've talked about this many times in the past as well.
Sure.
Baskets need to be consistent. And to me, I said this many years ago when the Disc Golf Pro Tour started, I think, just like kind of like, well, I don't know if the World Tour did it back then. I think, and they actually brought this up on one of the other, I saw somebody bring it up on some video. And I said this years ago, the Pro Tour needs a set of baskets. Now, whether that's the Pro Tour making their own baskets, mocked off of one of the other company's baskets, whatever.
Or choosing one.
Or if there's a bid.
Yeah.
From the manufacturers that make the baskets and say, hey, we will pay the Pro Tour this much, which goes to the players at that point in production, this much to use our baskets for this year or this 2 years or whatever.
It just needs to be standardized.
I think standardization in the Pro Tour is key moving forward. And tee pad size, and I don't know if I'm necessarily dead set on what the surface is, but the size has got to be standardized.
Sure.
Like, it just has to. You cannot have, you can't have Waco Lake. You can't do that to the pros. You can't. Yeah. It's not fair to them. Many people fell on those.
Yeah, that's not
Conrad, Yuli, they all bailed off those things, man. That's not good for your players. That's safety
first.
That's your product. Your players. The players are your product.
Sure.
So you don't want to ruin your product. I don't think it's the course size and that can all vary anyway. So I don't know, man. Right. Did that answer your question?
Yeah, it did.
Okay.
In a roundabout way.
All right. Well,
I think we got there.
Well, that's in a long-winded way for me because that's how I work.
Well, do you want to ask your question now?
What's your question? Okay, well, I'll do the one related to that, I guess. Okay. It's pretty directly related. Should the sport change to challenge the top five distance throwers, or should distance not be the only thing taken into consideration for tour events? So should distance not be the threshold of difficulty?
I don't think it is.
When you get to these open courses, those distance throwers have an, if you want to say, unfair advantage. Mm. Although, here's what I'm getting at with this. Actually, let me clarify.
All right.
Should 50% of the courses be wooded and 50% of the tour courses be more open?
I don't think that matters. I think it's the placement of the holes, right? You could take something that's flat out with no trees around and make it more difficult
with OB.
Absolutely.
You could do it with OB.
Yeah. You can make an island shot. You can make it
OB. Mm-hmm. The course of the future, the design of the future.
It depends on the course. Right. And here's the thing is you're not going to consistently get one or the other, and you're not going to get 50-50, right? You're going to get a tour. And on that tour, there will be a mixture of courses. So I think the qualifier of distance makes it difficult is absurd, right? We can do many things to make it more difficult other than just distance. Is distance a factor that can make it difficult? Absolutely. Should it be used? Of course. But should it be varied? Yes, right? When you're talking about pro level disc golf, right? Talking to you guys, accuracy and distance, right? And some would say accuracy is probably more important, right?
Well, especially when it comes to wooded courses.
Exactly. Yeah. So it has to kind of be a mixture just because of the nature of where these courses are and what you're going to play. You're never going to get the perfect scenario. You're never going to be able to blend it 50-50, right? Unless you, a whole bunch of money came in. Elon Musk was like, you know, I think my next weird thing that I'm going to do that's out of the blue is I'm going to change disc golf and I'm going to redesign every course, right? And,
I'm going to start emailing Elon. You know that now, right? You know that, right?
You go for it.
I'm going to start emailing him.
You go for it. But outside of that, you're going to have to mix it up and it's going to be varied. And I think both can be a factor. So do I think distance is the only? No, nor should it be.
I think more than anything, in relation to open versus wooded, I think if anything, there should be... The way you said it is correct. How you stated it is correct.
I know I said it.
Yes. However, what I'm getting at is I don't like that... disc golf over the past few years has been shifting more towards golf courses.
Okay.
I think over the past few years, it almost leans more towards those open courses. Do I like to watch a disc fly? Yes. Yes, I do. Mm-hmm. There are distance competitions for that. Do I want to have some open holes? Yes. Do I want to have some courses that are open, the whole course? Yes.
Yeah, that's cool.
I do not want it to fall that direction, though.
Where the majority of your courses
yes.
are that.
Okay. Yes. Yeah, I just I don't. Can, I really don't want that.
And I agree with you. Like, having one flavor would be very boring.
Well, the other thing, so here's another aspect to this question. Mm-hmm. And this is kind of where it stemmed from, but I forgot about this until I read my notes, which is, I'm glad I had them there. are we, and this is brought up by, I forget which pro it was that kind of mentioned it.
Okay.
But I took off with it here. Are we aging out pros too early?
Yes. Oh, not us. Okay.
are we aging out the pros too early? So what I mean by that is the older you get, the less elasticity your body has.
Yeah.
The less distance that's you're true. Going to have, right?
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of these pros, like Cale. Mm-hmm. Oh, that's who it was. That's who it was.
Cale?
Luke. Luke said this.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Luke said this. Go watch that interview.
Oh, yeah. I have to watch that.
He's on to something here. Mm-hmm. Luke said, I want to see Cale out on the pro tour more. Cale has moved to age-restricted divisions. Masters. Okay.
Gotcha. Gotcha.
Cale is a fantastic athlete.
Yeah.
He has one of the smoothest forms you will ever see.
Mm-hmm.
He can still throw like a champ.
Like the champ. Right.
He is an amazing disc golfer, but yet he feels almost held back because, well, by what I gathered from this discussion, it sounds like what Luke is seeing is that it's almost like Cale feels like, well, that's the next step because I can't keep up with these youngsters that can throw 650 feet or 600 feet or whatever, right? Mm-hmm. So is what I'm getting at is that distance factor keeping us from having a more, a wider field when it comes to pros that have been in the game for a long time?
That is a super interesting question because I would have to look into more of what the courses are and run some numbers to tell you yes or no on that.
And we should, because we should revisit
because
this.
And that's a good reason to also think about not having all of your courses be distance courses. Right. Another argument for that, at least. Right. If you wanted to go that way, but I couldn't answer you without knowing. Like, I don't know at the top.
Do
of
younger
my head.
Players have a natural advantage
on
athletically?
Distance? Sure.
Well, in general, ability, maneuverability and all that. Yes, they do. They do.
Well, and there's a slight advantage, especially what we're talking about age wise. And I'd have to probably see more of like a study on it, but hand eye coordination is better when you're younger. That's just a thing.
Yeah.
To a certain point. And but does that matter so much with disc golf? I don't know.
So like with golf,
and at what age?
I still enjoy seeing Tiger play.
Sure.
Is Tiger in the running at any of these events nowadays? He can be.
He could be. Yeah.
He could be. Mm-hmm. And people of his age are.
Yes.
Still.
Yes.
But with disc golf, it almost seems like the second you hit 35, I don't know if I can keep up with
disc
you guys.
Golf is different from golf in that respect.
Yes.
Though.
Like, yeah, it is.
And that just may be what it is with the sport. I mean, if you look at like football, you age out pretty early.
Like 32.
Right? But it's super physical.
Yeah.
But even, you know, baseball too, right?
Yeah.
That's a super physical sport. You're going to age out a little bit.
Yeah.
Right? When you start getting up in there in the upper 30s and, oof, gosh, 40. You're ancient.
I think in golf style games, I think we shouldn't be in a hurry to make it, we got to make it more difficult. Because that does kind of push out the people that grew it.
But at the same time,
you know what I mean?
You have to be cognizant of the fact that if the skill level is going up.
Oh, yes. Yes. Yeah. There is going to be.
You got to do something about it.
There is going to be.
Because at some point it's going to be ridiculous. Right.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I would even say like watching somebody birdie every single hole is like,
You mean like Macbeth twice?
Like, well, I mean, but when it's like the majority of your top 10 doing it,
yeah,
like, okay.
That was a discussion everybody's in the past too.
You know, basically you have to be darn near perfect, right, to do that, but it's not hard to be perfect when you're at that caliber. It starts to get boring, right?
Yeah.
Not saying we're there yet, but we're getting close.
Simon touched on that before. He touched on the fact that either we need to embrace one or the other. Mm-hmm. Either we make it more difficult to where the birdies aren't as prevalent,
mm-hmm.
or we embrace the fact that, yes, you will have 14 unders as at 12 double digits are a common score.
I guess.
So which one is more exciting ultimately? Is it the anticipation of how many birdies you're getting?
Right.
Or is it the anticipation of getting a birdie?
I guess I'm okay with double digits as long as, and we don't get to the point where we're taking away the ability to have like super exciting shots like aces.
Yeah.
Or albatrosses or something.
Oh, yeah. Like,
I always want that to be a possibility.
Oh, yeah.
I don't remove that from the game. As long as that's still a possibility. Okay. But I don't know. I could see it getting to a point where you're like, okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
As long as we don't get there.
Yeah. You have to, once an athlete breaks a course, you have to make those adjustments.
Absolutely.
You do. Okay. We have a couple more questions here.
Okay. We're going to go through them, right?
Yeah.
Hit them up.
Do you feel there should be an award ceremony rather than giving them a trophy after the final putt? So instead of right there on the green,
mm-hmm.
giving them the trophy and announcing them as the winner,
mm-hmm.
shouldn't the incidentals be taken care of before they just do that announcement right then and there? And what I mean by that mm-hmm. is in the case, rare, however rare it may be,
uh-huh.
if I win by one stroke, but I screwed up on one of my scores,
mm-hmm.
that's a 2-stroke penalty.
Yep.
And then I just lost by one stroke.
True.
So if they're awarding me this trophy on the green of 18 for winning this event, and I haven't turned in my scorecard and it hasn't been approved yet, that looks bad.
Well, everything's kind of digital.
Yeah, but you can still submit an incorrect scorecard.
I'm not saying you still can't mess that up, but that would be pretty rare, dude.
I'm just saying.
With so many people watching and like, you know, and those scores like going in digitally, that's pretty quick.
If it's a dominant win, I get it because there's no way like you can, let's say I won by 6. Like I can't screw up my scorecard that bad. I mean, you could technically, but
I guess.
The probability of it is very low.
I think the probability kind of even winning by one and messing up your scorecard.
So
it's pretty low.
You think that this inundated not inundated, I can't say that, that's the wrong word for it, idea of just applauding, applause is fine, mm-hmm. because you can applaud for somebody who didn't win because mm-hmm. they played well, right? So that's fine, but awarding them the trophy right then and there after they've sunk that last putt,
I'm fine with it.
Yeah.
Okay. And you want to know why I'm fine with it? Primarily, number one, Nick.
What's
speeds
that?
Speeds it up.
It does.
You know who's going to win? They hand you the trophy. We get the, yeah. And then we get the interview right afterwards with them. And that happens right away because we've already had that, right? And now we're having the, oh, yeah. And then I turn it off and go watch something else.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, listen.
And you know what? 99% of people are going to be turning off right after that interview. Hell, I bet you 80% of people are turning off before the interview. They see the trophy and they turn it off, or they go to something else.
Yeah, because they already know at that point.
And they know. So you're talking about people watching and getting more people in and getting those eyeballs on the thing. They're not going to stick around for an award ceremony, Nick.
Yeah, no, they won't.
And I'm not saying you shouldn't do both. Right?
Yes.
For the TV, for the televised event.
That's true.
Here you go. Here's your trophy. And then when the cameras are cut or whatever, you could even televise. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
But then we have the ceremony too.
And just to clarify, I'm not against it.
Yeah.
It was just something that.
No. And not saying you were. Yeah. I'm just saying that's my two cents. That's what that's what I feel. Like,
all right.
You can do both.
All right. Yeah, you can. You definitely can. That's mm-hmm. actually a pretty good option too.
Yep.
Because have an actual ceremony for the win. And it's not like it's got to take forever.
No.
you know. Yeah. But all right, all right. Last question.
Okay.
How much time do you actually play during a round of disc golf? So this is how much time
hands on
do
disc.
You hand on disc, step to your lie, throw, pick the disc up, not picking your bag up, not walking to the next tee, not walking physically to your playing. Lie, physically throwing, how much time?
I have no idea.
So the reason why I put this
somebody
on
run
here,
numbers on this already,
it's
I'm
absurd
sure.
Because okay. I videoed a friend of the show, Roger.
Mm-hmm.
I videoed him, I think it was 2 or 3 years ago at St. Paddy's.
Okay.
15 minutes.
Wow.
15 minutes. The whole round, you know, I divvied up. Now, yeah. Mind you, again, okay.
That doesn't surprise me.
Let's clarify. Mm-hmm. This is at Orange Vale, which right. is all par threes.
Mm-hmm.
This was the final round, so it's 18 holes,
mm-hmm.
and it's an A-tier event, so it's not like a pro tour.
That doesn't surprise me, though. 15.
Even if you take in a pro tour, yeah, it's a longer course,
yeah.
but that just means more walking. Yeah. That doesn't mean more throwing. Yeah.
15,
I mean, a little
20
bit more
minutes,
throwing.
Because you think about it, all the delay isn't you playing. All
nope.
of the delay is waiting for the next person to play
yep.
so that you can, and then the distance you have to travel to get to your lie and play.
Exactly.
So yeah. no, the majority of your time obviously is not playing. So 15, 20 minutes,
isn't
that doesn't
crazy,
sound
though?
Outrageous though. But if you think about that number, you're like, ugh,
you're like, I spend 2.5
terrible.
Hours on an average round. Like if you're out right. with your friends, like a foursome,
sure.
you're probably out there for 2.5 hours.
Sure.
I would say. If there's nobody out there, yeah, you can get done faster than that.
Real quick, yeah.
But at a tournament?
No.
15 minutes? That was a shock to me when I put it together for him.
I mean, that
like,
sucks.
I was like,
that
what?
Sucks if you think about it. You're like, man, I only spent
yeah.
15 minutes playing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, but yeah. Yeah. Makes sense.
Yeah.
That's a, yeah, it's
just
statistic.
A little interesting tidbit.
Right. Nick's tidbits.
No,
oh, that's what we're calling
that. Let's not call it that.
You don't want to be called it?
Yeah.
Nick's tidbits.
Size doesn't matter.
I think
Nick's
I
tidbits.
Think it's a,
let's not call
hey,
that.
I think you guys know where we're going, right? That's what we're doing.
Oh, man. Yeah.
Changing the show.
No.
All right, we calling it there?
Yeah, I think so. All I think
right.
we covered
so before
a bunch
we do,
of
there's
stuff.
A little bit of housekeeping we do have to do.
Oh, check out our video. You can see this. You'll see another video.
Oh yeah. If you're looking down below and you're wondering what those are, coming soon.
Yep.
To a unboxing video
near you.
That's right. YouTube.com/discgolfshow. Discdrifters.com. Use the code discgolfshow. All one word. Use that code right there at that place for 25% off of selected properties. If you don't know, discdrifters.com is a good place for you to go to plan out your trip. So we're talking about planning out your airfare, if that's the way that you go, planning out the hotels you're staying in on your trip. And if you can save 25% off of some of those properties just by using that code discgolfshow at discdrifters.com. Did I say it enough?
Do it.
Do it, right? It's a no-brainer. If you're in the market for a new disc golf bag or maybe just some gear, right? You can check out Upper Park Disc Golf. Use the code discgolfshow. Again, see what we're doing there? It's all the same. Get 15% off your purchase. So if you're in the, you know, realm for shopping for a bag and you want a quality bag, I'm a little biased because I have one, might as well save yourself 15% while you're there. It's good stuff. Check it out. Disc Golf Show for Upper Park Disc Golf. This show was brought to you in part by Final Nine Sports. 2 locations if you're in California, 1 in Rockland, 1 in Orangevale. Support local because you should, and you know you should, so do it. And I think that pretty much wraps it up for the show. If you have any comments for us, you can leave them in the comments down below if you're watching on the YouTubes, or you can shoot us an email at theshow@discgolfshow.com. And if you hated anything, if you didn't like anything, nick@discgolfshow.com. I think that does it for the show. And remember, in disc golf, as in life, aim high and let it fly.
I can show you the world.
Shining, shimmering, splendor.
Yeah.
Roly poly fish.
Yes.
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 Eat them up. Yum.
Oh, man. So good.
You know Bob Dole? He used to carry a pencil in one hand.
He liked pineapples?
Yep. And so people wouldn't try to shake his hand. Because he had problems.
Shut up.
With it.
Are you
he
serious?
He had problems with his hand.
So he purposely carried something?
He had
so
a pencil, you so you couldn't.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
All right.
Or at least that's the rumor. I don't know.
Any other politician things?
Yeah, the guy, which is it Eisenhower that was in a wheelchair?
Oh, there was one that was senile. Oh, no, that's the current president.
A whole new world. Shimmering rainbows bound for you.
Just something, I don't know. I got nothing.
You guys are amazing, mostly Justin.
I am I'm half
yeah.
Mexican, so.
You're half Mexican?
I'm married.
You can't claim that because you're married to a Mexican. No, that it doesn't work
that way.
That's
a thing.
No, it is not.
I can say a lot of stuff that I shouldn't if I was not.
To her.
Bye.